So if we can, we'd like to get started. Thank you. Today is September the 28th, 2023. It's about 2 minutes after 3 o'clock. This meeting is being held in a hybrid format with some members of the commission participating in person and some participating remotely as allowed pursuant to Chapter 20 of the Acts of 2021 as extended. How to be recognized at the appropriate time. Members of the commission, the applicant's team, and the public who wish to speak will be able to after being recognized. If you're in person, for those attending in person, commission members or applicant's team may raise their hand, and after being recognized, push the button on the microphone directly in front of their seat to speak, and push again to turn it off the mic once you're done. Members of the public attending in person will proceed to the podium to make comments during the public testimony section of the hearing. Once recognized by the chair, please state your name and then make your comments. Remember to turn on the microphone and turn off the microphone. For those online, click the, For those online, click the raise hand icon on the bottom of your screen. On some versions of Zoom, the raised hand icon will be under the more icon. For those who called in by phone, press *9 to raise your hand and *6 to mute and unmute yourself. You'll be recognized by name when it's your turn to speak. If anyone is having a technical issue, use either the chat box on your screen or call 508-362-3828 and staff will assist you. We'll be taking roll call vote on each action that we take today. Ask all commission members to turn on their video if available. We're recording the meeting for the purpose of creating minutes. If anyone is also recording the meeting, please identify yourself. Oh, no one. Thank you. The names of the commission members who are physically present and those who are remotely participating will be announced after attendance roll call is taken. Lisa, would you call the roll, please?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. Fred Chirigotis.
Here.
Stephen Mealy.
Here.
Elizabeth Taylor. Tom Wilson.
Here.
Richard Roy.
Here and happy to be in this room.
Thank you. Joy Brookshire. Joy Brookshire. Joe, you have to unmute.
I believe you muted, Joy.
Joy, I'll come back to you.
I think I got it.
Thank you, Joy.
You're welcome.
Jacqueline Edston. Jackie, you're muted. I'll come back to you, Jackie. Ernest Virgilio. Douglas Fromm.
Here.
Peter Oaken.
Here.
Harold Mitchell. Kevin Grunwald.
Here.
Richard Elkin.
Here.
Dennis Prebenson.
Here.
Ronald Bergstrom. John Harris. David Whedon. I'm going to go back to Jackie Edston.
Yes, now unmuted. It stated that the host wouldn't let me in.
Thank you, Jackie.
Okay.
We have 11 members present. For the record, Mr. Chair, the following members are physically present at the meeting: Fred Chirigotis, Stephen Mealy, Tom Wilson, Richard Roy, Douglas Fromm, Peter Oaken, and Dennis Prebenson. The following members are participating virtually by Zoom: Joy Brookshire, Jacqueline Edston, Kevin Grunwald, Richard Elkin. We have a quorum.
Thank you very much. So we have preliminary, we have some minutes from August the 17th, 2023. Has everyone had an opportunity to review those minutes?
Mr. Chair, if I can interrupt, please.
Yes.
This is Kevin Grunwald. Thank you. I just need to let you know, I know we're close in terms of a quorum. I will need to leave this meeting by 4:30 today. I have another commitment.
Thanks, Kevin.
Okay.
Anyone else? So with regard to the minutes, does anyone have any discussion, or do we have a motion?
Mr. Chair, if there's no discussion or if there's no corrections, I would move to accept the minutes as presented.
Do we have a second?
Mr. Chair, a second.
We have a motion and we have a second. This is a roll call vote. Would you call the roll, please, Lisa?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Fred Tiragotas?
Yes.
Stephen Mealy?
Yes.
Elizabeth Taylor?
Yes.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Tom Wilson?
Yes.
Richard Roy?
Yes.
Joy Brookshire?
Abstain.
Jacqueline Etzen?
Yes.
Douglas Fromm?
Yes.
Peter Okin?
Abstain.
Kevin Grunwald?
Yes.
Richard Elkin? Richard Elkin? I'll come back to Richard. Dennis Prebenson?
Yes.
Thank you. Richard Elkin? It looks like he's away from his computer. We have nine.
Thanks, Dick.
Thank you. We were voting on the minutes from 8:17.
Yes.
Thank you. We have 10 yes votes. Motion carries.
Thank you very much. Now we're going to have a public hearing and a potential vote on the Yarmouth Riverwalk project. Cape Cod Commission will conduct a public hearing on the following development of regional impact. The Cape Cod Commission will take testimony, discuss the project, and may vote whether to adopt the draft decision and approve the proposed project. Who is the applicant going to make this presentation? Well, the project is Yarmouth Riverwalk Park. Cape Cod Commission filed 22031. The project applicant is the town of Yarmouth. The project location is 669 Route 28, Yarmouth, Massachusetts. Assessor's ID map 32, parcel 122, map 24, parcels 92 and 176. Thank you very much. Now, if we have the applicant's presentation. Who's going to speak for the applicant?
I am.
Excellent.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Kathy Williams. I'm the Yarmouth Town Planner, and I want to thank you all for being here today to talk about our exciting Riverwalk Park project that we have. Also on Zoom is Jim Sabin, who is the chair of our Drive-In Site Utilization Committee, and also our consultants from Beta Group, Eric Golly and Laura Krause. So I'm going to give an overview of the project, but for any technical questions, Laura and Eric are here to answer those difficult questions. Next slide, please. So I'm sure you're all familiar with the site in general, but just to kind of give a little bit of a context here, the former drive-in site is really located in the very center of Route 28, which is our main commercial corridor, and it's surrounded by a bunch of different neighborhoods. The park's going to offer a really nice green space, perfectly situated for access to the Parkers River and also beautiful vista views to the marshlands to the south. Access to the site is available through the bus route, but we're also going to be having some significant improvements on walkability and bikeability by the proposed MassDOT corridor improvement project, which is going to run from the Barnstable town line to the Parkers River. And that's going to include bike lanes, shared use pathway along the south side of Route 28, and then also rapid flashing beacons, crosswalks throughout that section of Route 28. The next slide. A little background on the project. The town's owned this property for a really long time. We bought it back in 1986 for recreational purposes. And we had looked at a bunch of different recreational opportunities. At one time, we were looking at a marina. Unfortunately, that turned out to not be financially viable. So the Board of Selectmen in 2015 formed the Drive-In Site Utilization Committee to look at different uses for that fairly large 23-acre property. The outcome was to create some type of park with an event center and providing access to the water so we can kind of energize and reinvigorate that section of Route 28. We did conduct a detailed feasibility and conceptual design study back in 2017 and 2018. We also did that with our consultant Beta. Really looked very deeply at the Riverwalk Park, a boardwalk, and then in that open area for periodic event space. We had a very robust public engagement, very lively public engagement process at that time, and continued throughout the development of the park. It came up with some really good modifications, I think, that made the project better. We did a bunch of different improvements for safety and circulation in the park. One of the things that got changed from the boardwalk was, rather than going all the way across the marsh to Seagull Beach, we just ended up doing a nice little walking loop. And we also did some modifications to the alignment so that we could add some plantings to help some screening with the neighbors. And the big one is with the event space, we did a sound study to help reorient the temporary stage toward Route 28 so we weren't going to be causing any difficulties for our neighbors. Next slide. So we have a lot of project support. This project's been going on for quite a bit. We're very nearing completion with our permitting. And we have all of our funding in place for the project, which was a huge accomplishment. So we're also looking at developing, obviously this project has been on the books for 37 years. It's a little humbling to say that, but we have a great plan in place and a lot of great support. We do have in the DRI application was three support letters, one from the Board of Selectmen, one from the Planning Board, and one from our Community and Economic Development Committee. I always think the thing that talks loudest is when people are willing to kind of open their wallets and pay for a project. And we've been very, very fortunate. We have over $9.7 million in Community Preservation Act funds that have been allocated to this project, in addition to having a Land Water Conservation Fund grant, a Seaport Economic Council grant, and then some additional funding from the Department of Conservation and Recreation and our very own CHRS and Revenue Preservation Fund. We've also recently applied for a park grant that we're hoping to get. Next slide, please. So this is a great overview plan that kind of shows how the park and the boardwalk relate kind of to each other, but also to the wonderful surrounding areas. You can see how many neighborhoods will really benefit from having this park in this area. Next slide. This is just an overview of the entire Riverwalk Park. Each different element has a little number there to kind of orient you. The first one there, number one, is east of the entrance, and that's our proposed municipal pump station. Although it's not part of the Riverwalk Park project, we wanted to be sure that we coordinated with them with regard to the architecture, the landscaping, stormwater management with our consultant there. We just want to make sure that there's adequate space and that it fit in with the design of the rest of the park. We also have a restroom, item number seven there. That's going to have a temporary tight tank until we can connect into that pump station, which should become operational in 2026. Number two there is kind of indicating the entrance to the Route 28. Basically, the existing entrance to the property and our proposed entrance are going to be in the same general location, but we're going to have two exit lanes and one entrance lane that's going to be separated by a vegetated median. We also have a flexible third lane of reinforced turf grass along the entrance driveway that will help with traffic for any special events that we have there. And it'll also provide for some type of school bus parking in the interim. And then again, we have a little teardrop there that allows some turnarounds related to different, to facilitate different events there. We're gonna talk a little bit more about the entrance a little later with regard to the crosswalk. But coming in off of Route 28, the number three there is gonna be an 8-foot wide shared use path. It's gonna come in and loop around our open field area. So it's really gonna provide a lot of connectivity to Route 28 as well. So the main access road that we have coming in is going to have its own drainage system. It's going to have a vegetated swale. The swale is going to be pre-treating it prior to it going under the driveway entrance and being infiltrated into the ground. And the next slide we're going to go over, I'm going to talk a little bit more closer detail of the inner details. You could go to the next slide. Getting back to our numbering system here, number four, that's really a nice, a smaller pathway, but it's located closer to the Parcels River, so you can really get some nice views down the river. Number five there is showing the 88 parking spaces, which has porous pavement for the actual parking spaces itself, but pavement for the travel lane because of durability. You're going to have decorative lighting, and then we also have a turnaround at the end. There will be some additional event space parking that's available on the western side of the grass area, so there will be some field parking during those larger events. The parking lot was elevated to help allow and accommodate for that subsurface drainage, but also to reduce localized flooding with climate change. The next few items, we're going to talk about a little bit more detail in the presentation, but I wanted to orient them for you here. Number six is the artist shanties, which are kind of being located around a meandering pathway. Number seven is that elevated restroom. Number eight is the playground area, and then nine is the kayak launch. The big area in the center there, number 10, that's our event space for periodic events that can be used for a wide number of different types of events, you know, from boat car shows, could be craft fairs, we've had pirate festivals, carnivals, and there could be some type of performances or concerts. Little squared area and rectangles that you see there, kind of laid out for having some type of performance. So it was like a temporary stage in an audience area. This temporary stage was located specifically there after a sound study that was conducted to make sure that we had the best orientation away from the neighborhoods and towards Route 28 so we wouldn't be bothering impacting our neighbors. Also peppered throughout the site will be interpretive signage and educational signage and mapping route. Also throughout the park, there are stormwater management elements. They include, again, as I mentioned, those porous pavement parking spaces with all the collection underneath. There's going to be an infiltration basin and floor base at the end of that southern cul-de-sac to treat that stormwater runoff. There's a subsurface infiltration area near the restrooms and the surrounding walkways. And then there's also in the open space there where it's being graded so it can provide treatment over the grass area before it goes into underground infiltration. And of course, we're going to have a stormwater operation maintenance manual to make sure that the stormwater systems operate as designed in the long term. This entire project was very thoughtfully designed to minimize and mitigate impacts to the various wetland and environmental resources that are on the site. And again, that's fully documented, I think, in the DRI application. The vast majority of the impacts to the riverfront area are already in sections that have already previously been developed due to the drive-in and are already degraded areas. So we're going to be mitigating areas, including removal of debris and refuse. We're going to be planting a larger quantity of native vegetation. We're also going to be doing invasive species management. And then there's a whole bunch of different mitigation measures that we will be doing during construction, such as time of year restrictions on certain work, and also having a stormwater pollution prevention plan. We also did, as part of this analysis, a very detailed flow analysis to see how stormwater would flow onto and off of the property. We wanted to be sure that we weren't channelizing any storm flows and causing any erosion. Next slide, please. This is just a blow up kind of showing you what the restrooms look like. We really wanted to keep the architecture simple and have it incorporate those Cape Cod style architecture. We did include a hip roof and a cupola, similar to our very successful Packet Landing project. We have a beautiful pavilion there that's very well received. We're also going to be incorporating drinking water fountains and, of course, a filling station, which are so popular now. As the entire site and the restroom is located in a floodplain, what we're doing is we're going to be elevating the ground around the restrooms to elevation 12, and then we're going to be dry floodproofing the building itself to elevation 15. So it's going to be protected up to 2 feet above the base flood elevation to help address some of that climate change that's coming. This also allowed it to be a little bit more handicap accessible versus being something that was sticking up much higher above the grade. The floor plan has restrooms for men's and women's, but also provides a little office space for use during special events and then also a mechanical storage area. So this is an unconditioned restroom. We're not gonna have heating or cooling, and it has a relatively small roof area, but we have accommodated that it would be solar ready, and we have some obviously water saving fixtures throughout the restroom. Next slide. This just kind of shows you the artist shanty area. What we really learned is that you need to engage the particular area. You can't just have the artist shanties off in one area and expect people to try to go over there. You need to incorporate it into the park itself. So we have this meandering pathway where we're gonna also have public art. We're gonna have yard games, some shade structures, kind of really invigorate this area in addition to having the artist shanties. We did be sure that we located all of the artist shanties outside that 100-foot riverfront area. Next slide. This is kind of showing the playground area and just the bunch of different elements that we're looking at, having a play tunnel, the double slides with a climbing wall, a swing. And we're also hoping to incorporate a pirate ship, which will really keep in with the theme of the many adjacent businesses. We have the Whit of Pirate Museum across the street. And of course, we have Pirate Cove mini golf as well. Then we'll be including picnic benches and tables throughout the area. Next slide. This is just showing you a couple pictures, and hopefully we'll be able to put that pirate ship in there on the right. We had that recently installed at our Sandy Pond recreation area, and it's very, very popular. Next slide. This is the kayak launch. We really had to pick a very specific location for the kayak launch. We wanted to make sure that we were having minimal impacts to salt marsh as possible. So we picked an area where the salt marsh that was a very narrow strip, and it also picked an area where there's a bulb out in the river itself. So it allows people to launch their kayaks, orient themselves before they get into the navigable portion of the river. We do need to have a little elevated boardwalk to go over that salt marsh to make sure that we're not causing any shading issues. And then we have gangplanks that go down to zero entry floats for easy access. We're also looking at having a space for kayak rental racks and a shed for a potential kayak vendor at that location. And we're also going to be incorporating signage with different rules and safety regulations related to kayaking. Next slide. And then all of this moves through the beautiful woods, through some paths to the 6 foot wide elevated boardwalk, which is going to have three overlooks. We'll have an interpretive signage about, you know, the wildlife you might see on the marsh, the different, the marsh itself. And then we're also going to have four benches, and then there's going to be a little bridge over the inlet. We also conducted a very detailed foundation analysis, and we settled on the use of vehicle anchors. Again, the thoughtfulness with the layout played on the boardwalk itself. We do have a lot of environmental resources here. We wanted to make sure that we were locating the boardwalk so it wasn't impacting some of the smaller outcrops of salt marsh. There's the big salt pan in the center there that you can see it says existing marsh. There's also some elevated wooded areas that are used for perching, respite for birds that we didn't want to be impacting. We also wanted to be thoughtful of our neighbors and locating it behind certain areas where they could be naturally screened through existing vegetation, or on the west side, we modified the layout in order to incorporate some plantings on some elevated areas within the marsh itself. Taking into consideration vertical elements, the height above the marsh, we tried to keep the 1-to-1 ratio, meaning we're having a 6 foot wide boardwalk. So we wanted to have a minimum 6 foot over the marsh to make sure that the sun can get there, so we're not having permanent damage to the salt marsh. But when we were looking in our east-west corridors, we tried to elevate that a little bit because we wanted to be sure even more sunlight got in there, and also to accommodate the overlooks. Obviously, we'll have to have a little bit of a 5% grade to accommodate that change, but it's all going to be completely handicapped accessible. So allow everyone to have access and be able to enjoy the views of the marsh. Next slide, please. Yeah, this is just an aerial view of the existing site driveway. Again, as I mentioned, the project driveway will be in a very similar location to this. During that Mass DOT corridor study that I had mentioned earlier, they are going to be including a crosswalk that's going to be on the west or the left side of the driveway, and that will include a rapid flashing beacon. But that project's not anticipated to start until 2028. And our Riverwalk project is anticipated to be completed in 2025. So due to this timing gap, the town will coordinate with the state and other agencies to install some type of mid-block crosswalk with handicap ramps somewhere near our driveway entrance. As this is something that's interim until Mass DOT project is completed, it may make some sense to have the crosswalk on the east side or the right side of our driveway so that we avoid any right-of-way issues until it's addressed as part of the Mass DOT project. Next slide. So this is a plan showing the latest entrance layout that we developed in order to address comments that we received from Mass DOT during the permitting process. Mass DOT has requested that the permit application plans be modified this way to include the actual crosswalk across the our driveway to remain within the Mass DOT layout. This would be an interim measure until we can have the driveway access and crosswalk as we presented in the DRI plans constructed as part of that Mass DOT corridor project. And at that time, the Mass DOT project would incorporate that crosswalk with a flashing beacon on the west side of our entrance. Next slide. So this is somewhat of an unusual DRI project because it was triggered by our MEPA EIR certificate since we're located in an environmental justice area. So prior to triggering that jurisdiction, we were able to complete all of our local permitting, kind of verifying that we are consistent with our municipal development bylaws. So we have the Conservation Commission order conditions, a stormwater management permit from CONCOM. We've gone through the planning board for the VCOD site plan review process. We got a special permit from the Zoning Board of Appeals for the boardwalk. We've got approval from the health department for the temporary tight tank and then our septic connection to the pump station. And then, of course, we do have that MEPA single environmental impact certification. Permits that are kind of have been submitted and are in the works are the combined Chapter 91 401 water quality. That has completed its public comment period, and we hope it to go to the governor for signature in a few weeks. We have a Section 404 general permit authorization from Army Corps. That's something that's typically done after the Chapter 91 permits issued. We are in the 75 to 100% review phase with our MassDOT highway access permit. And of course, we're in the Cape Cod Commission DRI process right now. The only pending permit application for submissions are really ones that get done by the contractor, which is a stormwater pollution prevention plan, and then the building permit for the restroom structure. Next slide. So the project funding, design, and permitting is really on track for us to start construction on this project in January. I know it says January 2023, but it's 2024, with an anticipated completion date of May 2025. So I know that the commission is going to be reviewing their report, but we do concur with their staff report indicating that the project is consistent with the applicable sections of the regional policy plan and that the project does have an overwhelming number of public benefits. Thank you.
Thank you. We have comments from the staff. Jeff?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. For the record, Jeffrey Ribeiro, regulatory planner here with the Cape Cod Commission. I'll try to keep my comments brief. I think Kathy did a very good job providing an overview of the project. This project comes to us as a DRI due to it requiring an environmental impact report under the Massachusetts Environmental Policy Act. This is one where an environmental notification form was triggered, and the proximity to an environmental justice community is what triggered the mandatory environmental impact report. So this is one of those ones coming in that new threshold that we have discussed before. The DRI hearing period was opened procedurally on August 7th. The CPR served as subcommittee. This is something we've done, I think, once before now for a project that is coming to us because of that environmental justice threshold. They held a hearing last week and then met earlier this week to recommend a draft decision, which was distributed to you earlier this week, but that very closely mirrors the staff report that you've had for a few weeks. All of the findings are consistent. In the draft decision are consistent with that staff report. You will notice in the application that the letters from town boards in support of the project reference an exemption. This is something that staff discussed, and because the salt marsh is a regional resource and really there are regional benefits to this project, staff felt that the more appropriate way to handle it was through DRI review rather than an exemption. So, we kind of agreed, I think, with Kathy that if the board support an exemption, they probably would support approval as well. And the findings of those letters stand. I'm going to provide some brief RPP consistency comments, but I'll just note too that we do have some of our technical staff here present. As far as the ones who worked on this project, we have Jessica Rempel, Natural Resources Analyst, Kathleen Mason, Water Resources Analyst, and Colleen Medeiros, our Transportation Program Manager. The issue areas applicable and material to the project, I'm going to run through the ones on the left really quickly, because again, I think that the consistency is pretty simple. When it comes to community design, the buildings proposed are small. They utilize traditional forms and materials. The parking is also broken up with planting islands between the various areas. For cultural heritage, the project received a sign-off from the Massachusetts Historical Commission on its project notification form. Additionally, there's no inventory of historic structures in the vicinity. For wildlife and plant habitat, there's a large wetlands restoration aspect to this project, which is a significant benefit to wildlife and plant habitat. As part of that too, there's invasive species management, and the project did receive a quote no take letter from the Natural Heritage and Endangered Species Program at the state, which again means that there's no impacts to listed rare species. For open space, the entirety of the site is currently Article 97 protected open space. So that's protected in perpetuity. And also for the second objective, public access is something that we encourage. So this obviously increases public access to the park, but also the salt marsh. Coastal resources, the town did considerable work on flood management. You know, being a water dependent use, we need to be near the water here. And for climate mitigation, the buildings are unconditioned, so we don't need to worry about kind of green heating or cooling because there is none. Also, the bike and pedestrian improvements proposed are part of the methods for meeting our climate mitigation goals, as are the environmental improvements associated with the project utilizing native species. So I'm going to get into a little more detailed discussion of water resources, wetland resources, and transportation. For water resources, we're not in any drinking water protection areas here, and there are no nearby drinking water wells. The nitrogen loading is very limited. It really only comes from changes in impervious surfaces. The sewer, the bathroom will be sewered, but there's a temporary tight tank, which also prevents any nitrogen from going into the embayment. There is a theoretical, again, I say because it's 0.06 parts per million nitrogen increase in nitrogen loading. But that is actually, again, in addition to being theoretical here, almost it and de minimis. Because we're in a marine water recharge area where the town of Yarmouth has adopted a comprehensive wastewater management plan that is approved by the commission under the 208 process. And that plan will remove nitrogen greater than the total maximum daily load determined to the embayment. Additions to of nitrogen can be allowed in these areas. So again, it is consistent regardless. And, you know, with stormwater management, we can go to the next slide. So the existing, you can see, really has no stormwater treatment to speak of. So the conditions that we end up getting are significant amounts of untreated stormwater flowing directly into Parker's River. If we go to the next slide, here again, too, just to point out the rain gardens and other native plantings, that buffer between the impervious surfaces and the river, that will all help to infiltrate and filter any stormwater. For wetland resources, we generally do not allow alteration, except for when there is a public benefit. Here, again, as we discussed under open space, public access is something that the commission supports. It also includes water-dependent uses, which is another area where we do allow wetland resource impacts. The stormwater improvements will greatly improve, again, the health of these, as well as the wetlands restoration, invasive species management, et cetera. And the impacts to the wetland, the salt marsh, are minimized through, I have the diagram up here of the helical piles, which you know, greatly lessen impacts as opposed to force-driven piles. They're also going to use rubber tracked equipment to minimize any matting, time of year restrictions, et cetera. The last issue area I just want to discuss a little more detail is transportation. The applicant provided a reasonably comprehensive traffic impact report, which was reviewed by our transportation staff, and staff agrees that the project will not significantly degrade any traffic operations on Route 28. The internal path network, which connects to existing sidewalk and transit facilities, is another benefit here. There are bus routes along Route 28. Kathy also discussed that MassDOT Route 28 project, which currently is on the Transportation Improvement Program. So that is, I believe, scheduled for 2028 or 2029 now. That can certainly shift, but that will provide wider shoulders on Route 28, a shared use path on the southern side of the road, directly abutting the park here, sidewalk upgrades on the northern side. And those are at the 75% design level. So that project is coming along. Still, again, as Kathy discussed, if we go to the next one, I would say the one kind of condition that goes a little bit beyond a form condition as far as, you know, customarily submitting a plan that might currently be in draft form or other kind of procedural conditions is to provide that crosswalk along Route 28. So, you know, the town has committed to provide a crossing here as a stopgap measure to until that larger Route 28 project is done. For other review standards, the most of the local permits were obtained already. That's atypical for a DRI, but is allowable here due to the nature of the MEPA process, particularly with its location near that environmental justice community and the determination of the requirement of environmental impact report by the Secretary of Environmental Affairs. There are also no applicable DCPC implementing regulations to the site. The project is expressly stated as consistent with the open space goals of the town. It's perhaps unsurprising that they've been working on this for so long that it would be an included project in the comprehensive plan. And it also does further support the economic development and community well-being goals of the LCP. Last, benefits and detriments. These were included in the staff report as well as in the draft decision. And the project will provide a recreational park for public use that improves a underutilized site. It'll provide public access to the salt marsh with minimized impacts. It will provide those opportunities for local artists in the shacks at a community scale. And it will provide new public access to the river via that canoe and kayak launch. And the only detriment identified was that there will be some impacts to salt marsh, even if those are, mitigated to a large extent and unavoidable for water dependent use. And the ultimate determination that those benefits largely outweigh the detriment. And then just for an overview of what we're going to do here today, we'll happy to answer any questions. Again, we have our staff here, as well as Kathy Williams, the town planner, and I believe she has her technical consultants as well. We'll take any public comment, and then we'll have your discussion in a potential vote. Thank you very much, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Jeff. So do we have any initial questions by any commission members? Anyone? Elizabeth?
Thank you. I don't remember if I asked this at our committee meeting. Is there anything set up for the transportation for DART or any of those buses to come into the facility?
Yes.
Spot there?
You did ask that question.
Okay, thank you.
It's okay. Right now we don't have anything formalized, but they certainly have the ability very easily to come in and turn around. We have two loops there. If we have like larger events or periodically they want to come in, they're more than welcome to do so.
Thank you. I just didn't have my notes from the last meeting with me. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Kevin.
Thanks, Mr. Chair. Thanks to both the applicant and to staff for your presentations. They were really very clear. I like this project. I like the walkability of aspects related to what's in the surrounding area. I have more of a procedural question. I think maybe this is more for Jeff, but I know we have some latitude in terms of use of subcommittees, but I'm not recalling, and I may just be forgetting, when we've used the CPR as a subcommittee in the past. So could you just explain the process to me and the rationale for deciding to use the CPR as a subcommittee here?
Thank you, Kevin. The recent project, I believe it was Cable 91, which we heard about a month ago, I think. I think that we are seeing projects that don't necessarily meet the traditional scale of DRIs coming in through this environmental justice threshold because it's so different from the other MEPA thresholds that trigger an EIR. So we've kind of sought to do a somewhat expedited process here. And we've found it expedient to have the Committee on Planning and Regulation meet instead at one of their regular meetings, so we don't have to kind of push things out trying to schedule meetings. And also the town is under time deadlines here with funding, so we wanted to make sure that we did what we could to accommodate them.
Thank you, Jeff. That certainly makes sense to me. I said, my memory sometimes fades these days, so I wasn't recalling the previous project. I do recall a project from several years ago where we waived the requirements for a subcommittee, and I think it ended up really being somewhat of a disaster, but this is a very different project. I understand the expedience. So thank you for that answer.
Anyone else? Seeing no more hands, we'll open this for public testimony. We'd like to begin with any federal, state, or local officials. If anyone would like to speak, please raise your hand. Anyone from the general public wish to speak on this project? Jim Sabin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and commissioners. I appreciate you taking the time to hear this. I am the Drive-In Site Utilization Committee Chair. This is a very exciting project that we've been working on. Actually, if you look at the site, we've been working on it for 30 something years, but our committee has worked on it since 2015, as Kathy has indicated. And we have had over 50 hearings and meetings during the process to really make sure that this project is something that our community can be proud of. And we think that it's going to really be vital to the economic development of Route 28, and we'd appreciate the support that you'd provide us today. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Do we have any response from either the applicant or the staff? None needed. How many additional questions or comments from or discussion from commission members? Tom, yes, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. What impressed me the most about this project was a word that was used often by the applicant, and that is thoughtful. In terms of the design, in terms of the accessibility, in terms of creating open space for the public, I am so impressed with what is before us today, and I just want to state that I strongly support this DRI project.
Thank you. Anyone else? What I can say is I'm sorry. Hi, Jackie.
Hi there. Yes, as I've said at the other two meetings on this project, what a pleasure it was to have a plan before us like this that was so well planned. It assesses the natural resources of the site. It really showcases them. It provides for many activities at many levels for people. It's respectful of those natural resources. So congratulations to Yarmouth and to the planner and to all the other people who worked on this. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Yes, sir.
Second time we've heard this presentation. We heard it in the subcommittee. And just another shout out, which I said the other day, to Kathy Williams. for just an excellent, concise presentation of this project to us. It's an exciting project to say, but the presentation of it to us was just excellent. Appreciate that very much.
I agree. Anyone else? Seeing no one else, we could entertain a potential motion to approve the Riverwalk development of regional impact and adopt the DRI approval decision as presented. Does anyone wish to make that motion?
So moved.
Dennis Prevenson.
Dennis Prevenson.
Second.
We have a motion and a second from Jackie, I believe. Mm-hmm. This will be a roll call vote. Lisa, would you call the roll, please?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. Fred Chirigotas?
Yes.
Stephen Mealy?
Yes.
Elizabeth Taylor?
Yes.
Tom Wilson?
Yes.
Richard Roy?
Yes.
Joy Brookshire? Joy Brookshire? I'll come back to Joy. Jacqueline Etston?
Yes.
Douglas Fromm?
Yes.
Peter Oaken?
Yes.
Kevin Grunwald?
Yes.
Richard Elkin?
Yes.
Dennis Prevenson?
Yes.
Joy Brookshire?
Yes.
Thank you, Joy.
You're
we
welcome.
Have 12 yes votes, motion carries.
Thank you very much.
Good job.
With that, we could move on to the Cape Cod Regional Pond Monitoring Program. Tara? Tara Lewis.
Good afternoon. I'm Tara Lewis, a Water Resources Analyst with the Cape Cod Commission. I'm going to provide an update on the Freshwater Initiative. Next slide, David. I'm sure you've all seen this slide a number of times. The Freshwater Initiative is a science-based planning process that involves stakeholders with the goal of protecting and restoring freshwater ponds. Here on the slide are the various components of the Freshwater Initiative. Today, I'm going to do an update on the monitoring program as well as the remote sensing. The first portion will be on the monitoring program. In partnership with our Association to Preserve Cape Cod and the Center for Coastal Studies, we launched the regional monitoring program. It is designed to complement existing monitoring efforts and provide baseline data regarding how different types of ponds on Cape Cod respond to changing regional environmental conditions throughout the summer as well as from year to year. So the ponds on Cape Cod, as you all have heard, are individual, unique, and important to the region's identity, all 890 of them. We can't realistically monitor all of these ponds. So we spent some very thoughtful process in selecting representative subset of the ponds for monitoring that captures both the range and distribution of these different pond characteristics. Wait, hold on just a second, Dave. So how do we get from 890 ponds to 50 ponds? So we looked at pond characteristics, things such as pond depth and pond size. We looked at the watershed development, or watershed characteristics, specifically development within the watershed. We also looked at existing monitoring and water quality status of the ponds. We looked at public use, both past and present. And we also looked at spatial coverage across all towns and the six aquifer lenses. The pond selection was coordinated with municipal and other monitoring programs to prevent duplicating efforts and to maximize data coverage throughout the Cape. So through this process, we arrived at the 50 ponds that you see here. They're the little black dots along that map of Cape Cod. And on the right, you'll see the various characteristics of these different ponds. Let me hold on just one second. I have to minimize this window so I can see. So we have 38 ponds with delineated watersheds, 33 ponds with biological data, 14 ponds with herring runs, 19 ponds with surface connections, and 6 ponds with implementation or restoration projects. You can see on the far side of the slide, we have ponds by size distribution. On the x-axis is the pond size in acres, and the number of ponds in each of those categories is above the bars. You can see the ponds by depth class, as well as the pond development within those watersheds. We have very low amounts of development, and we have all the way up to very high levels of development. The program was launched in April of this year, and it will occur, has been occurring monthly. We are almost done with September. We have one more month to do the monitoring in October. We have one sampling location per pond, and it's in the deepest part of the pond. We're collecting parameters in the field. We're measuring dissolved oxygen, temperature, pH, specific conductivity, and Secchi disk. We are collecting samples that will be analyzed in the lab for nitrogen, phosphorus, chlorophyll A, and alkalinity. Number of ponds we've monitored so far in April include 25 ponds. And then in May, we monitored 49 ponds. And then we monitored 50 ponds, June, July, August, September. We're almost done. And then we have one more month left, October. The monitoring data for April and May, go back a second, David. The monitoring data for April and May, we have received that data, and it has been entered into the regional water quality monitoring, the regional water quality database. So to date, we have collected nearly 300 water quality samples. Next slide. So now I'm going to move on to the remote sensing. The project, the remote sensing project, uses satellite-derived imagery and existing pond water quality data to quantify ponds in, to quantify changes in pond characteristics. So we're using Landsat 5, 7, 8, and 9, and Sentinel 2 satellite imagery. We're connecting it with the water clarity, and the imagery is calibrated with field measurements of Secchi disk depth taken during satellite overpass. The existing data set is incomplete. The manual data collection is labor intensive and time intensive. And it is collected by multiple entities and jurisdictions. So the hope with the remote sensing is to fill some of these gaps by providing continuous data collection across jurisdictions, timely and cost-effective estimates for decision-making, long-term stability of estimates, and retrospective analysis, which is pretty cool, and all to provide a more complete picture. I'm gonna talk just a little bit about water clarity. The way we measure water clarity is with a Secchi disk. That's that, that image on the right. It's about a dinner plate size disk, has white and black quadrats. And you lower into the water, the farther down you can lower that Secchi disk, the more clear the water is. And so we do this, we have this measurement, Secchi disk depth, which is very difficult to say, but try. Secchi disk depth measurements are available for about 217 ponds from 2001 to 2022. We have maximum pond depth for about 200 ponds. So we need both of those, the Secchi disk depth and the maximum depth, to be used for this project. The project objectives are to use the satellite imagery to predict clarity by analyzing its relationship with field measured Secchi disk depth, to assess long-term changes in Secchi disk depth as an indicator of changing water clarity, and to define a framework for identifying ponds year over year or year to year changes in water clarity, specifically for targeted management efforts. So this criteria that I mentioned, we need to have ponds that are at least 2.5 acres, that have Secchi disk measurements taken during the satellite overpass, and then also maximum pond depth data. So we have about 200 ponds, as I mentioned. About 195 of these ponds were really well suited for use with the satellite imagery analysis. So our findings are that Landsat is well equipped to provide multiple estimates per year of Secchi disk depth across Cape Cod ponds. Satellite image also can identify ponds with significant year-over-year decreases or changes in Secchi disk depth. And this is done, again, to prioritize management efforts. So with the success of these findings with this remote sensing project, we are now pursuing funding to develop automated remote sensing methods for water quality mapping from 2017 to 2016 to better understand changing conditions across the Cape and the ponds. And I think that's it. I do have one more slide. I just wanted to put up after this thank you slide. This is the list of the ponds that are included in the pond monitoring program. So give you guys a chance to check those out. And I don't know if there's an opportunity for questions. Yes, I'll be happy to take any questions if anyone has any.
Does anyone have any questions? We'll start with Tom Wilson, then we'll get right to Doug. Go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just have a question about the satellite imagery. I know where I live in Chatham, so many days are cloudy until 12:30, 1 o'clock in the afternoon. How does satellite imagery deal with that?
It doesn't. Right. It is definitely a con of the project. There are some cloud masking filters or applications that can be put in place so that they can still sense information beyond the cloud. But definitely that is one of the issues with remote sensing is cloud coverage. But the thing about the satellites is they're so frequent. They fly by the Cape so many within a month that there's a good chance we can catch the ponds when there aren't clouds.
Okay, thank you.
Doug, sure. And then Elizabeth.
Having done water sampling in Orleans for a number of years, this doesn't replace that. It's in addition to that and improving on that.
Yes, it's in addition to and improving on, and a lot of the ponds that we can't get to, this is a good application for those ponds so that where there aren't volunteers monitoring or town staff or any organization doing the monitoring, this allows us to access a lot of those ponds that we haven't been able to get to. It also can look into history, and a lot of the data that has been collected since 2001 can be used retroactively with the imagery, because we also have the imagery from 1984, whenever satellites were flying around initially. So there's some good historic perspective that we can put on the changing clarity in ponds.
More question, if I may. This is data collected, it's analysis and so forth to tell us the condition of the ponds, correct?
Well, it can tell us water clarity, doesn't now always necessarily equate to water quality. There is good correlations, but there's a little bit more involved than just a simple one-to-one.
So does this relate to what we hear in the summer about algae blooms and so forth, which has to do with water quality?
And also water clarity, yes.
Okay. And maybe if this is inappropriate, tell me, but I'm hearing a lot of discussion about alum. Do you, as the commission, do we make proposals on solutions, or do we stay kind of neutral on that?
That is going to be the next time we do an update. We'll talk about the strategies database, which has a compilation of all the options of restoration strategies that one can use on a pond, including alum. But it is a much more diverse and far-reaching database of options that one can use.
So you would present options to
present towns. Options. Yep, and you need a lot of information about your town, about your pond, and if it's internal loading, external loading, what the contributing factors are, the depth of the pond, the residence time, the volume. There's so many things that go into deciding how to do a pond restoration. I don't that we would be presenting those options in those approaches.
Okay.
Thank you, Elizabeth.
Thank you. Now I know that the towns do individually pond monitoring, and APCC does it, and the commission does it. Does all this data end up somewhere in the same pot?
That's actually what we're working towards, is getting all of that data into the same centralized location that is easily accessible to anyone who is interested in looking at the various ponds and the data that are being collected by all these different entities.
Thank you.
And can I just follow up one question I wanted to continue? We need the volunteer water quality monitoring data, specifically the Secutis data, to do the remote sensing project. So it's never not going to replace the volunteer monitoring.
So to follow up with that, I know that many of these ponds have associations that are out and very interested in their own ponds, and they're are you able to collect and coordinate with them to get that data? Or that, and I'm sure there are some that aren't on the list that could help. One of the questions I had was, do you also monitor for invasive plant species and maybe even fish species? I know people let koi go out and it changes the habitat. Is that also something that you're looking at?
It is not currently part of the regional pond monitoring program, but there's always the opportunity to add additional parameters that need to be monitored. So something to be considered for future, but it's not part of this 3-year monitoring program that we're currently in.
Anyone else? Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
With that, do we have any other issues before us today? Anything unanticipated? If not, what do we anticipate? I see someone quickly. Yes, Tom.
I would move to adjourn, Mr. Chair.
Any discussion? Do we have a second?
Second.
Thank you very much. Lisa, if we could have a vote on a motion to adjourn.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. Fred Chirigotis?
Yes.
Stephen Mealy?
Yes.
Elizabeth Taylor?
Sorry, yes.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Tom Wilson?
Yes.
Richard Roy?
Yes.
Joy Brookshire?
Yes.
Jacqueline Edston?
Yes.
Douglas Fromm?
Yes.
Peter Oaken?
Yes.
Kevin Grunwald?
Yes.
Richard Elkin?
Yes.
Dennis Prevenson?
Yes.
Thank you, members. We have 12 yeses, motion carries.
Thank you very much. I just noticed it didn't take a lot of prompting to get a vote on that. Thank you. Goodbye.